Amen. Thank you, Tim. Well, good morning. And thank you, Juliet, for reading both our scriptures today. Well, as we've heard, today is Palm Sunday. And my first memory of Palm Sunday was when I went to Sunday school as a child. And I was given pussy willow instead of a palm cross. Was anybody else given pussy willow? Why? Why were we given pussy willow? I have no idea. Anyway, today we will be receiving our real palm crosses to remind us of the start of the last week of Jesus' life on earth, the beginning of Holy Week. It's a really familiar story told in our reading from John's Gospel, but also recorded in Mark and Luke. Jesus riding into Jerusalem on a donkey, with the crowds hailing him as their king. And this event was prophesied by Zechariah, who says in his book, chapter 9, verse 9, "Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion, shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." Now here, I have to admit that I've always struggled a bit with Palm Sunday. We sometimes sing hymns reflecting the crowds rejoicing, and we can sometimes, as we did this morning, have children dancing, and adults, dancing around the church, waving banners and branches, and that's all fine. But in my mind, I'm fast-forwarding to Good Friday, when the crowd, rather than hailing Jesus as their King and Saviour, are calling for his death, shouting, "Crucify him." At Diane's funeral service earlier in the year, we sang a hymn which was chosen by her. "My song is love unknown." And one of the verses says, "Sometimes they strew his way and his sweet praises sing, resounding all the day, hosannas to their king. Then crucify is all their breath, and for his death they thirst and cry." What has happened in between in just 5 days? Now, some commentators say that it's not the same crowd. And our reading today certainly seems to suggest that the crowd hailing Jesus as their king were visitors to Jerusalem for the Passover festival, and that the crowd that called for his death were those living in Jerusalem. Now, if you've been to Jerusalem, you will know that the old city is not very big, and it was known to be very crowded at Passover time. And it's unlikely that there wasn't some mixing of the two communities, that those who were rejoicing over their king were now involved in the crowd calling for his death. And even if there was no mixing, the inhabitants of Jerusalem had seen Jesus at work. They'd marveled at his teaching. They'd seen his miracles of healing. And in Luke 19:47, it says, "After that," that's after he came into Jerusalem, "he taught daily in the temple. But the leading priests, the teachers of religious law, and the other leaders of the people began planning how to kill him. But they could think of nothing, because all the people hung on every word he said." So this happened during Holy Week. People were enthralled. Other versions say they were amazed. And furthermore, it's recorded in Mark's Gospel that crowds from Jerusalem travelled up to Galilee to follow Jesus. So people from outside Jerusalem and those lived there had both seen Jesus at work. They'd seen him performing miracles and listened and been amazed by his teaching. So what happened to turn the crowd against him so quickly? If we follow Jesus' journey, we know that he really annoyed the leaders of the community, the priests, the Pharisees, etc., and they were always looking for a way to discredit him or dispose of him. Jesus did not fit their idea of a king, someone who could rescue them from the Roman occupation. And in addition, they didn't recognize him as their promised Messiah. If they had connected the prophetic writings of which they were so fond of studying, they should have known better. After Jesus' arrest and sentence, they found their chance to do the dirty with the custom of releasing a prisoner over the Passover period. In Mark 15:11, it says, "But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have Pilate release Barabbas instead of Jesus." So there we are, the people who had either rejoiced at Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem or had witnessed his miracles and listened to his teaching were now calling for his death, all in the short space of 5 days or less. They had been influenced by their respected religious leaders who should have known better. Now, as I once again felt uncomfortable about this passage, I began to think about the ways in which we are influenced. And really, this is what I really want to focus on this morning, what I'd like us to think about. Now, influencing is a big thing nowadays. You can even make a career out of it. Who knew? Not something that was in my career teacher's list of things to do. And there are whole industries devoted to persuading you to think in a certain way. The advertising industry, the PR industry, journalism, social media, and the list goes on. Just an example, if you regularly read the Daily Mail, the chances are you will lean politically to the right. And if you regularly read the Guardian, you'll probably lean politically to the left. Even if you didn't start out that way, you will be influenced by what you read. What we take in inevitably influences our thinking and behaviour. And in the West, today we are absolutely bombarded with information which seeks to alter the way we think. Advertising nowadays seeks you to persuade to buy a car the size of a double-decker bus, even if there are only two of you and you can't afford it. We listen to the news on the television and can no longer be sure it's unbiased or even true sometimes. And the internet is even worse, spouting fake news, distorting science, and worse. And we've seen that this week, haven't we, in the disgraceful way in which Kate, the Princess of Wales, has been treated, and the way that people have believed what they've read on TikTok or on other media. I have to say that I do worry for our young people who are addicted to their phones with no filters. And this includes our granddaughter, Alice, who in a couple of years will probably have her own phone. And despite having diligent parents who'll do their best to put safeguards in place, we know she'll be at risk of harmful influences. I'm not surprised to learn that internet safety is now part of the Year 6 curriculum. How sad is that? So these are just some of the examples of influences that particularly young people face that I've picked up from the press, just the normal press, over the past few weeks as I've been thinking about this talk. So, an 8-year-old girl whose skin has been damaged because she used a potion recommended by an influencer on TikTok to help her look younger. An article entitled Failure to Act on Suicide Website Linked to 50 UK Deaths. Websites dedicated to helping young people self-harm without it being noticed. And I'm sure Youthscape will have a lot to say about that. Women dying and suffering severe infections after going to Turkey for butt lifts after being persuaded by influencers that they need to change their appearance. That's funny, this. In my day, the cry was, does my bum look big in this? But now it's, does my bum look big enough in this? But Marks and Spencers, don't worry, Marks and Spencers now do a set of pants which will make it look bigger. No need to go to Turkey. Anyway, but joking aside, it is a serious problem when people are dying and being injured because they are being influenced to alter their appearance by people with no proper qualifications or knowledge. What happened to the trust in God's word, which says in Psalm 139, I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. And what about Mr. Google? When we search for information, how do we know that what we read is true or just someone's opinion? We need to be really careful. As Christians, we need to be upholders of the truth, whether it's the truth of God's word or accurate factual information. Now, as I was going through the Bible in the year, that's a tick for me because I'm doing it, I read this from Proverbs 1. My child, if sinners entice you, turn your back on them. They may say, come and join us. Let's hide and kill someone. Just for fun, let's ambush the innocent. Let's swallow them alive like the grave. Let's swallow them whole like those who go down to the pit of death. Think of the great things we'll get. We'll fill our houses with all the stuff we take. Come, throw in your lot with us. We'll all share the loot. My child, don't go along with them. Stay far away from their paths. They rush to commit evil deeds. They hurry to commit murder. And as I read this, I was immediately reminded of the sad case of Brianna Gay, murdered for fun by two children from her school. Doesn't it resonate with you too? Her killers had spent hours on the internet and the dark web looking up how to murder someone, watching live torture and other horrendous content. It's no wonder that their minds were warped. And influenced here is perhaps too gentle a word by what they were watching. And in these verses, we hear God's word to us, giving us warnings and advice to protect ourselves and others from those who would seek to influence us for evil. When we read the papers, watch TV, search the internet, or connect with social media, as Christians, we need to view these things through the lens of God's word. And our second reading this morning gives sound advice on how to live in a world when everyone is trying to influence us all of the time. And I recommend you go back later today to have another look at that. In fact, many of the writings in Proverbs follow a similar theme. Don't be taken in. Seek wisdom. Choose your friends wisely. Stay away from unhelpful speech and gossip. And above all, know and follow God's word. In Philippians chapter 4, verse 8, it says, "Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about these things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you." And Romans 12, 2 says, "Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will." Now, this is sound, practical advice for each of us as we navigate today's world of social media, television, TikTok, that was in my day was the sound of clockmate, anyhow, the press, advertising, and even the influence of our friends and colleagues. When we read, watch, or listen to anything, we need to think about whether or not we're being influenced. And if we are, can we hold it up against these readings? Is it true? Is it necessary? Is it harmful? What will be the consequences of our actions for ourselves and for others? Now, of course, not all influence is harmful. Some is simply neutral. I really don't think God minds very much whether we choose DFS or Furniture Village for our new sofa. And there are many positive influences in our lives, and I very much hope that I can influence you this morning. And I'm sure Tim feels the same as he speaks. And as we look back in history, we can see the wonderful influence that people have had in our world and society. The abolition of slavery, reform of the prison system, for example, and more up-to-date, the work of David Attenborough to make us more aware of our beautiful planet. Teachers have failed if they don't influence the children. And as parents and grandparents, we all hope to be a good example to our children, to help them to grow up, to be decent human beings and responsible citizens. But we need the wisdom of God to help us discern what is good and what is harmful. And on the ground, as a church family, we can help each other. When we see one of our brothers and sisters being pulled off track, we need to have the courage and the gentleness to speak to them and hold them accountable. God says we are to encourage and admonish one another. In today's world, where there are so many pressures, it's good to be able to support one another, to stand firm and not to follow the crowd. Now let's get back to the story. We see the religious leaders whipping up the crowd to cry for Jesus' crucifixion, but they're not the only ones being influenced. If you remember, Jesus went on to appear before Pilate, the Roman governor. The Jewish leaders did everything in their power to persuade him to put Jesus to death, even though he could find no charge against him. But there was another influence at work for Pilate. His wife had had a dream warning them that Jesus was innocent. So Pilate was torn between the two influences. He took the coward's way out and washed his hands of the affair. So the Jewish leaders got their way and the crowd called for Jesus' death. Luke 23:23 says, "But with loud shouts they insistently demanded that he be crucified, and their shouts prevailed." Now we do need to take a breath here. We know that Jesus was born to die. It was all part of God's rescue plan for the world that he loves. That Jesus' death would save those of us who believe from our sins and eternity in hell. So can't the crowd be excused for calling for his death? After all, if they'd chosen Jesus over Barabbas to be saved, how would God's plan have been fulfilled? We need to remember that God knows the end from the beginning. He knew how it would all end. But that doesn't excuse individuals in that crowd for calling for the death of an innocent man. Although God knew how things would work out, he will hold each individual accountable for their actions. And it's the same for us today. It's sometimes difficult not to follow the crowd, but when that crowd is heading in the wrong direction, we need to stand firm. Maybe to put on the armour of God, as the children were learning about earlier in the year. To be bold and courageous to resist harmful influences, and to be a positive influence in our families, our communities, and our world. And if we don't, we will face judgment. You may feel that you don't have much of an influence on anyone. But in the Bible in a Year reading for the 4th of February, the commentary says this: according to sociologists, even the most isolated individual will influence 10,000 other people during his or her lifetime. That's a lot of people that you can influence. And in the same day's reading, Nikki Gumbel says, "As Christians, we have influence over others in different ways. To be called by God to influence others is an enormous privilege, but it carries with it great responsibility." So it's something to think about, isn't it? We face many pressures in today's world, and we need God's wisdom to help us make good decisions and avoid harmful ones. Who are the people over whom we have influence? Are we making a positive difference? And how will God view our decisions? We'll be getting our palm crosses at the end of the service. The next time you feel you are being unduly influenced or have to make a decision, just hold up your palm cross in your mind and ask for God's wisdom and guidance. How does your decision hold up against God's word? Think again about Philippians 4, verse 8, which says, "Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things." Don't be like one of the crowd that turned from hailing Jesus as their king to calling for his crucifixion just 5 days later. Amen.